Good morning and welcome to worship with the congregation of the Presbyterian Church at Peace Chapel. We are glad you can be here with us, whether you are here in the chapel or out in Zoom world. And there, the camera came to find me. Good. We're sorry for the little bit of a delay. If you're out in Zoom world, you're noticing maybe that the perspectives on the camera are kind of changed a bit too. That's because the camera has finally gotten to move to what will be its permanent mounting place. So the good news about that is that now that once we've got all the adjustments in the right place, they aren't going to change every week, which they've been doing for ever since we moved over here to Peace Chapel. The bad news came this morning. You know the old joke about the person calling their computer repairman, and the first thing the computer repairman asks when they say, "I'm having problems getting my computer to start," is it plugged in? Because that's always the joke is, okay, if you don't plug it in. Well, it turns out you have to plug it into the right hole as well. And our audio was plugged into the wrong hole and was now 8 feet in the air plugged into the wrong hole. So that was a little bit of a problem, but we're all set now. So we're glad you can be here with us today on this third Sunday of Easter. And part of our new life is that the tech is working maybe a little better, we hope. If you are out in Zoom world, you're going to see the bulletin on your screen, and it will scroll through right along with what we're doing all through worship. We invite you to read aloud with us the lines that are in bold print and sing along with the songs, even though you are muted, so you can be taking part in worship with us. If you're out in Zoom world, of course, you can't come up to the plate at offertory time, but we do invite you to make use of the Vanco, V-A-N-C-O, Vanco Mobile Faith Engagement app. So if you put Vanco Mobile Faith Engagement into your phone's app store or into your computer's browser, it will find the free download for you from the Presbyterians, and then you can enter Presbyterian Church at Peace Chapel, and you'll be all set, and it will help you give electronically. If you'd like to be a little more old school about it, you can always write a check and mail it to 1212 Livingston Avenue in North Brunswick, 08902. Children are encouraged to have paper and pencils or crayons ready when we get to the sermon so they can draw pictures. We'll talk about that a little more before the scripture lesson. Now, all of those things are settled and we can really get started, so I'm going to invite Chris to play through our gathering song, and then we'll sing it a few times, and along the way I'll invite the congregation to stand. Be not afraid, sing out for joy, Christ is risen, alleluia. Be not afraid, sing out for joy, Christ is risen, alleluia. Be not afraid, sing out for joy, Christ is risen, alleluia. Be not afraid, sing out for joy, Christ is risen, alleluia. Be not afraid, sing out for joy, Christ is risen, alleluia. Be not afraid, sing out for joy, Christ is risen, alleluia. We begin worship in Easter with the oldest greeting of the church. Let us worship God. Alleluia, the Lord is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. God, you shield me on all sides. You ground my feet and lift my head high. With all my might, I shout up to God, who answers from God's holy mountain. Real help comes from God. May your blessing be on your people. Chris is going to play through the psalm, and then we'll all sing. Thank you. answer when I call, great God, you found me once in great distress and gave me room to wriggle free. Now hear my prayers again, come bless. How can fools live in sin-swamped mess and lust for lies, ignoring God? Come see who has been picked by God for faith, formed life, and answered prayer. The way is hard, he may complain, but must let our hearts speak with care. Then with the best we have to share, we'll trust and build our case for God. Accept the grace-gorged love of God, whose answering face shines warm and bright. We whine and moan, but get our fill of everything that's good and right. We're safe and sound straight through the night, because you hear us call, great God. Beloved in Christ, I greet you with grace and peace in the name of God our Father and our Master Jesus Christ. Our God gives us everything we need, makes us everything we are to be. Please be seated for prayer. And let us now confess our sins and leave our burdens at God's feet so that we may go forth free and forgiven, living out the promise of our baptism, the promise of Easter. Let us do all this beginning with the prayer you find on your screens and in your leaflets. Let us pray. God of life, we are often tempted to doubt your lordship, often tempted to choose the ways of death. We go to the tomb expecting to find the body of our Lord Jesus, or we hide in our upper room as if to lock you out of our lives. Forgive our faithless expectation. Overcome the barriers we erect. Shatter our doubt with the wonderful words, "He has risen." Renew our hearts, resurrect our lives with the good news of our living Lord. Listen for these to these words that we may trust from the prophet Isaiah. You will say in that day, "Thank you, God. You were angry, but your anger wasn't forever. You withdrew your anger and moved in and comforted me." Yes, indeed, God is our salvation. We will trust, we won't be afraid. Cry aloud and sing your hearts out, O Zion. The greatest lives among us, the Holy One of Israel. Believe this good news and live in peace. Alleluia, 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 now the Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia, 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 el Señor resucitó. If you're serious about living this new resurrection life with Christ, act like it. Pursue the things over which Christ presides. Don't shuffle along, eyes to the ground, absorbed with things right in front of you. Look up and be alert to what is going on around Christ. That's where the action is. see things from his perspective. Our old life is dead. Our new life, our real life, is with Christ in God. And as we live this new life, this real life, we hear these words from the Apostle Paul. Christ came and proclaimed peace to the outsiders and the insiders. No one is a stranger or an alien. We all belong to God's household. Beloved in Christ, the peace of Christ be always with you and also with you. Let us greet one another with a hand of fellowship and the peace of Christ. Peace of Christ. Peace, Lillian.
Peace of Christ.
Peace. Peace of Christ. Peace of Christ. Peace. Peace, Richard. Peace, Sam. Peace. For next week, we're going to try to have a little one of those trapeze things in the ceiling, so you can do that.
Yes,
you missed the ladder. Peace, 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 Helen, peace, Tom.
Yes. Okay. Another time. Don't worry.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Now the Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. Alleluia, 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 el Señor resucitó. Now we come to the time when we visit with the young children before Bible stories and sermons and all of that good stuff. And so if you're a young child out in Zoom world, or even just a child at heart, this is that time to find that paper and pencil and stuff. But just listen for a moment. We have a story today, still about Easter. We're still telling stories that are on the first day of the week they begin with, which means there's still stories from that very first Easter day. Jesus was very busy that day. And his apostles and friends were very busy trying to keep up with him. But in this particular story, on this particular early Easter day, while it's now kind of late in the day, one of the things that's going to be cool about this story is that you've got a couple of Jesus's friends, a couple of his disciples, who are out for a walk. And trying to get out of Jerusalem. They're tired of being in Jerusalem. And the other thing that's cool is that they aren't ones that we've talked about before, all through the Gospels. You know, it talks about his 12 disciples who become the 12 apostles, and it talks about the Marys, but that doesn't mean that those were the only disciples. There were other people following Jesus around, other people listening to the stories and doing things with him. And it turns out that one of them was named Cleopas. We know that because he's going to show up in this story. Cleopas is. It's the first time and the last time we hear about him in the Bible. And it says Cleopas, and it talks about his friend, and it doesn't even tell us who that friend is. We know Cleopas's name, but then there's somebody else whose name we don't even know. So there are these extra people. So that's a cool thing. And it sounds like maybe, you know, they were kind of around, but they didn't get to do the important stuff. Well, this time they're going to get to do important stuff. And this time they're going to get to recognize Jesus. But it's going to take them a little while. You might remember from Easter Day in our Bible story that Mary didn't recognize Jesus at first. Well, this time, Cleopas and his friend aren't going to recognize Jesus at first, even though they talked to him for a long time. But then they're going to recognize him when he sits down for a meal with them and breaks the bread. And then as soon as they recognize him, he's gone and they've got some other things to do, and you'll hear about that, because this kind of changes their lives. So then we've got the other Bible piece we're going to have, which isn't a story. It's another piece of the letter, to the first letter of John. And remember, we said that the John who writes in 1 John is not the John who wrote the Gospels, and is not the Gospel, and is not the John who wrote the Revelation. There were lots of people named John. It was a pretty common name back then. Probably still is. You probably know somebody named John or Johnny or Jack or something like that. So, in this part of 1 John, what we're going to hear about is how we're all becoming something and we don't know what it is yet. And so that's certainly true for Cleopas and his friend. And it's going to be true for the other apostles, and we'll hear about that in the story from Luke. And it also says, we don't know what we're becoming, but we know we're not supposed to be sinners. Well, we know that. And we know that we're not practicing sin. We don't try to sin anymore. But that sometimes, you know, we get things wrong. And that's why every week we get to confess and be forgiven and start over again. So we'll hear about that. And we'll hear that the most important thing we're supposed to do is love each other. Now, you may remember I've told you before that there are four different words for love in the New Testament, because the New Testament was written down first in Greek. And in Greek at the time, there were four different words. And one of those words, the one that is most often in the New Testament, is agape. And agape means you're going to give everything for this person you love, even though you don't think you're going to get anything back. It's not romantic love, and it's not love like you have for a member of your family or a good friend, but it's this love where you just give everything. And you might also have that for your family or your good friends. And this is the love. When John says we're all supposed to love each other, this is the love he talks about. We're all supposed to do everything for each other and take care of each other. So be thinking about that, and be thinking about how that helps us become whoever it is we're becoming that we don't know about yet. And you can be drawing pictures about that or about the Bible story during the sermon if you'd like. So, of course, always before we pray in church, or before we have Bible stories in church, I should say, we pray. And at the end of the prayer, we say, yes, amen. So you guys say the amen. The grown-ups are going to help me with the prayer. Ready? Let's pray. Jesus is alive and out and about. So is God's word alive for us. A tomb couldn't hold the Savior. Printed pages can't hold God's truth. God, as you open the tomb for us to see, open our hearts for us to grow. And we all say amen. Listen for a word from God in this story from the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. On that same day, the first day of the week, two disciples were traveling to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking to each other about everything that had happened. While they were discussing these things, Jesus himself arrived and joined them on their journey, but they were prevented from recognizing him. He said to them, "What are you talking about as you walk along?" They stopped, looking sad. The one named Cleopas replied, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who is unaware of the things that have taken place here over the last few days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things that happened to Jesus of Nazareth. He was a man of God, a prophet, dynamic in work and word, blessed by both God and all the people. Then our high priests and leaders betrayed him, got him sentenced to death, and crucified him. And we had our hopes up that he was the one about to deliver Israel. And now it is the third day since it happened. But now some of our women have completely confused us. Early this morning, they were at the tomb, and they couldn't find his body. They came back with the story that they'd seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Some of our friends went off to the tomb to check and found it empty, just as the women said. But they didn't see Jesus. Then he said to them, "So thick-headed, so slow-hearted, why can't you simply believe all that the prophets said? Don't you see that these things had to happen, that the Messiah had to suffer and only then enter into his glory?" Then he started beginning with the books of Moses and went straight on through all the prophets, pointing out everything in the scriptures that referred to him. They came to the edge of the village where they were headed. He acted as if he was going on, but they pressed him, "Stay with us. It's nearly evening and the day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. As he took his seat at the table with them, he took the bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, but he disappeared from their sight. They said to each other, "Didn't we feel our hearts on fire when he spoke to us along the road and when he explained the scriptures to us?" They didn't waste a minute. They were up and on their way back to Jerusalem. They found the 11 and their friends gathered together, talking away. "It's really happened," they said. "The Master has been raised up. Simon saw him." Then the two went over everything that happened on the road and how they recognized him when he broke the bread. While they were talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said, "Peace to you." They were scared half to death. They thought they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened and why do doubts rise up in your hearts? Look at my hands and feet. It's really me. Touch me and see, for a ghost doesn't have flesh and bones like you see I have." As he said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. They still couldn't believe what they were seeing. It was all too much. It seemed too good to be true. He said to them, "Do you have anything to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it right before their eyes. Then he said, "Everything I told you while I was with you comes to this. All the things written about me in the law of Moses, in the prophets, and in the Psalms have to be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds so that they could understand the scriptures. He said, "You can see how it is written that the Messiah suffers, rises from the dead on the third day, and then a total life change through the forgiveness of sins is proclaimed in his name to all nations, starting from here, from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." And listen for a word from God in this portion of the first letter of John. "See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God. That's who we really are. But that's also why the world doesn't recognize us or take us seriously, because it has no idea who Christ is or what he's up to. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we know is that when Christ is openly revealed, we'll see him, and in seeing him, become like him. All who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. Everyone who commits sin breaks God's law, for that is what sin is by definition, a breaking of God's law. Surely you know that Christ showed up in order to get rid of sin. There is no sin in him, and sin is not part of his program. Now, no one who lives deeply in Christ makes a practice of sin. None of those who do practice sin have taken a good look at Christ. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as Christ is righteous. Everyone who commits sin is of the devil, for the devil has been sinning from the beginning. The Son of God was revealed for this purpose, to destroy the works of the devil. Those born from God don't practice sin because God's DNA remains in them. They can't sin because they are born from God. The children of God and the children of the devil are revealed in this way. All who do not do what is right are not from God. Nor are those who do not love a brother or a sister. For this is the message you have heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God. It's interesting where life takes us. So much of what I am now doing is kind of the life I expected, the person I expected. I am pastoring, I'm teaching, I am married to Kathleen, I am writing a bit, and church music, which was my undergraduate degree, is involved in my life. But so much of what I'm doing, I think, would be a complete surprise to past me. Pastoring part-time, teaching at New Brunswick Seminary, teaching church history and writing, of all things, and having my involvement with church music be mostly in writing texts, not music. 40 years ago, when I graduated from college, and yes, it was 40 years ago next month, I'd have told you that I'd be pastoring college students now, teaching about hymns and worship mostly, creating tunes and music instead of hymn texts. And that's just the start of it. I never would have imagined the time that I spend editing. That was my dad's thing. I didn't want to do that. Or the time I spend doing denominational things or caring for Kathleen, or that Christopher, my son, would be a chef. Beloved, we are God's children now, we read. What we will be has not yet been revealed. That's what it says in 1 John. And it has to do with how we walk in God's love and how God surprises us. God in Christ surprised Cleopas and his friend, who were good guys, who loved Jesus, but who never expected to be apostles or evangelists or anybody important, like Peter, James, John, Mary, and the others in the inner circle, the cool kids. They knew that they were just followers. And when there was nobody to follow, they were done, and they were hiking out to Emmaus. But God knew differently. And their meeting with Jesus sent them running back to Jerusalem, running back in the dark. Meeting Jesus, recognizing him, feeling their hearts on fire, gave them a story to tell, a song to sing. And that song revealed the evangelists who it turns out they truly were. Thanks to Jesus' resurrection, we have a song that reveals who we truly are. By the way, it also reveals that we are also sinners, getting so many notes wrong when we shouldn't. We don't practice sin, not anymore. We don't go out looking to be defiant and self-centered. We just fall into it. And then we do our best to get out of it. We fall into sin and we repent and we try to be better. And we help each other out. Because we love each other. The agape love that I was talking to the children about that gives expecting nothing in return. We love people for who they are, even the parts that we don't like. We help one another while avoiding any attempts, as best we can, to fix each other. Because it's not very loving when we go around trying to fix our friends. And when we get it wrong, we forgive each other. And along the way, we become people. We become friends. We become a church we never imagined. Along the way, if we keep loving, we become who God always knew we could be. And then we become even more. In all of this, we are witnesses to the new life the new love God gives us through hospitality that opens our minds and gives us a total life change over and over and over. Look around. Who would have expected that this is who we would become? Imagine where Christ's life may take us, what it may reveal in us next. Let us pray. Write these words in our hearts, dear God, and help them to grow up in us the fruits of your Spirit, to the honor and praise of your name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Chris is going to play through the hymn, and then we'll all sing. The risen Christ who walks on wounded feet, from garden, tomb, through darkened city street, unlocks the door of grief, despair, and fear, and speaks a word of peace to all who hear. The risen Christ, who stands with wounded side, breathes out his Spirit on us to abide, whose faith still wavers, who dare not believe. New grace, new strength, new purpose we receive. The risen Christ, who breaks with wounded hand the bread for those who fail to understand, reveals himself despite our lingering fears. In flames our hearts then quickly disappear. May we, Christ's body, walk and serve and stand with thee, oppressed in this and every land, till all are blessed and can our blessing be restored in Christ to true humanity. And now let us affirm our faith using the words from 1 Corinthians that you find on your screens and in your leaflets. Let us say what we believe. Our teachers in the faith handed on to us what they in turn had received. Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, and he was buried, and he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. And he appeared to Peter, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. By the grace of God, we are what we are. So we proclaim, so we have come to believe. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Now the Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. El Señor resucitó. Please be seated. And I'm glad to be able to welcome everybody once again to worship this morning. We are coming to the time when we share our joys and our concerns before we share our offerings and then share in prayer together. And so as we do that, I invite folks who are out in Zoom world who have joys or concerns to share to go ahead and press or turn off your mute, I should say. So you go down to and you click on the little microphone if you have a screen. If you're on a phone without a screen, you press *6 and that will turn off your mute and you'll be all set. And while we get ready for that, we'll share just a few announcements about what's coming up in the next few weeks as we continue through Easter. Next Saturday, Presbyterian women have a gathering on gender equality and poverty over at Brick Presbyterian Church. There are details in the Saturday email that went out. And by the way, if you don't get the Saturday email and you would like to, send your email address to office@presbyteriannewbrunswick, all one word, presbyteriannewbrunswick.org. And then we will make sure you get added to that list and it gets sent to you every week. And you'll find out all the things that we talk about that are in the Saturday email. So that's next Saturday, and I believe it's next Thursday that's the deadline for RSVPing, so check that out. Next Sunday we'll be here again for the fourth Sunday of Easter, and we will worship together, and then after worship, the session will have a meeting, so all session members are reminded that we have to get ready for that and have that meeting. And then there's food distribution at the Bayard Street Church a week from next Saturday, the last Saturday of the month. Extra helpers are always welcome. We are still collecting spaghetti sauce, especially during the month of April, but any other non-perishable foods are welcome. And there's the box that's right there, and there's a basket out in the narthex, and you can drop those things off as you arrive. We have had a lot more need for food than we've had food to give out for many, many months now. So please be thinking about what non-perishable food you could share and get that in and help out. And then we'll be back again on the 28th. And then on May 5th, we'll have worship and we'll have the Lord's Supper. And it'll be the sixth Sunday of Easter. So we'll have only one more Sunday left after that. And then it will be Pentecost. So things are moving along through springtime and through Eastertide as we celebrate new life. Is there anybody we need to remember, especially in our prayers this week? And I think, first of all, we should remember Tom Parr and his family. Tom's brother John died this past week, and the funeral will be tomorrow at Dayton Presbyterian. Okay, so let's keep them in our prayers. Anybody else? Helen.
First of all, to remember Israel and all of the Middle East, really in need of all of our prayers. Prayers for my son Travis's family. The grandfather passed away yesterday. He's a pastor of a Presbyterian church in Fox Lake area in Wisconsin.
Okay, so it was
his name is Paul.
Okay, it was Paul who passed away. Okay, let's keep them in our prayers especially. Rosina?
Yeah, prayers for my mom and also family back home, as my mom lost her sister last weekend, so prayers for strength.
Okay, and what was your sister's name?
Lydia.
So prayers for all of their family and the loss of Lydia. Anybody else? Sam.
prayers for traveling message for my wife who has gone to a country, Sierra Leone, and she'll be returning next month. So we need a traveling message for her.
Okay. Anybody else? Any other joys or concerns? Let's continue to keep Carol in our prayers as she continues her rehab. And O'Neely. And I see Martha. Martha, go ahead.
Just to add to Helen's prayer for Israel. The whole world is on fire at different levels. Some of it's just small embers and others is high flames. We know that God has brought us through the fires and he knows the hurts in our lives, and we know that he could make it all go away with just one wave of his hand. But sometimes he doesn't. And even if he doesn't, he needs to remain our hope. So we need to pray for the strength and the faith to remember that mountains that remain unmoved are still under his control, and that he is our hope alone. And when we put our faith in others, we are walking down a very dangerous path. And I thank God for his faithfulness. Mm-hmm.
So we'll be praying for the world, be praying for God's providence, and remember the old story about the person who said, I asked you to help, God, I asked you to help. The world needed help, and God said, and why do you think I sent them you? Think of it, be praying for what it is that we can do to be making things better. Okay, listen to these words from the psalmist. What shall I return to God for all God's bounty to me? I will give what I have promised in the presence of all God's people. And so let us now with gladness present our tithes and our offerings from our life and from our labor unto our God. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. We have gathered together, O God, because we know Christ is alive. And we have recognized and we have heard your new life, your word for us. And we recognize your new life. And we feel our hearts on fire. We look to the world around us, to all the people in it, the wonder and majesty of your creation, all of its problems and possibilities. And we recognize your new life. And we feel our hearts on fire. And so we pray for this world and for all its peoples, especially the people of Ukraine and the soldiers of Russia, the people of Israel, Gaza, Iran, Lebanon, Yemen, and so much of the Middle East. People from all the world, people who are refugees in so many places, refugees from war, from violence, from disasters, people just trying to keep their families safe and to give their families a chance at life, facing huge obstacles as they do so. We pray for those women and men who lay down their lives for the safety of brothers and sisters and neighbors wherever they might be. And we pray for those who lead us, for our president and representatives, our governor and legislators, people who administer the affairs of our nation, our state, our cities and towns, and those who administer nations and states and cities and towns all around this world, that whether they profess your name or not, they might lead us into your truth, your freedom, your peace. We look at the people around us, people with various gifts and needs, people with various colors and languages and personalities, and we recognize your new life, and we feel our hearts on fire. And so we pray especially for those with special needs this day. And we pray for the lost and the lonely. We pray for those imprisoned, whether by bars or fears or poverty or oppression. And we pray for those who are ill and those who are weak, especially for O'Neely and for Carol, for Mimi and her grandchildren. We pray for those who are traveling that they may be kept safe. We pray for those who grieve, for John's family, Paul's family, Lydia's family. We pray for all those whose names we remember in our hearts and those whose names we don't know yet. We look at ourselves, called to be your body in the world, to all of us who understand you in many ways, yet celebrate one Lord, one faith, one baptism around one table. And we recognize your new life, and we feel our hearts on fire. And so we pray for ourselves, your holy church, for this congregation gathered here, for our sisters and brothers in and around North and New Brunswick, for the churches of the Presbytery of the Coastlands and the Presbyterian Church USA, her colleges, seminaries, missions, and ministries, and for all those who proclaim your good news and live it out wherever they might be. Together around your table, O God, we see how Christ is alive. We have shared your love for us, and we recognize your new life, and we feel our hearts on fire. Now we leave here and return to the world, trusting you to hear all our prayers in the name of Christ alive, who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Chris is going to play through the hymn, and then we'll all sing. Come ye faithful, raise the strain of triumphant gladness. God has brought forth Israel into joy from sadness. Loosed from Pharaoh's bitter yoke, Jacob's sons and daughters. Led them with unmoistened foot through the Red Sea waters. 'Tis the spring of souls today. Christ has burst his prison, and from 3 days sleep in death, as a sun has risen. All the winter of our sins, long and dark is flying. From the light to whom we give laud and praise undying. Now the queen of seasons bright, with the day of splendor, with the royal feast of peace, comes its joy to render. Comes to glad Jerusalem, who with true affection welcomes in unwearied strains Jesus' resurrection. Neither might the gates of death, nor the tomb's dark portal, nor the watchers, nor the seal, hold you as a mortal. But today among your own, you appear bestowing your deep peace, which evermore passes human knowing. You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. You are God's own people, in order that together we may proclaim the mighty acts of the one who calls us out of darkness and into God's marvelous light. And so may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be and abide with us all this day and always. And may all God's people say together, Amen. Amen.